The Sierra Club high trips, which were conducted from 1901 till about 1960, were 1 month hiking trips. You could go in the first 2 weeks, or the last 2 weeks, or all 4 weeks. The cost of the 4 weeks trip was $70. The way the trip was operated, the people would hike along the trail from camp to camp, but all the heavy things were carried by a pack train of mules run by professional packers. The heavy things constituted people's dunnage, their sleeping bags, and so forth. This is not the pack train. This is just lazy hikers who didn't want to walk. Well, then there were the camp stoves and the tools and other things that had to be carried from camp to camp. Here comes the pack train. The man on front is a professional packer. He does this all year through, every year. Or I should say he did. I don't know whether these are conducted nowadays. A base camp was a camp where we would sleep several nights in the same place. In the intervening days, we could climb nearby mountains, or have tea parties, or go fishing, or lie in the sun and sleep, or talk with our friends. There was lots to do, and it was very pleasant. I was out in a barge floating by camp when I took these pictures. Now, since this trip lasted for a matter of weeks, of course there had to be washing done. You could always get hot water from commissary and big buckets, and each family had to wash its own stuff. This is tea, which is kept available during the daytime when we were not moving camp. Here you see part of the group having lunch. You'd pick a soft rock or a comfortable log or the ground and sit and eat the lunch provided by commissary. Here Nelson Best, Virginia Adams' brother, is holding up some quartz crystal that he got on the ground somewhere. Then the life on the lake was very pleasant. You could sit by the lake and do nothing, or you could go swimming. I don't know whether anybody fished. I didn't. These three little boys built a kind of a float out of some logs and some pieces of wood and went coasting by, having a good time all day. Well, that wasn't all accidental. The boys cooperated with me to give a little scenic effect. Here's another lunch scene on a different day. Now, there was plenty of dead wood lying on the ground from the forests that had been there for centuries, and so we could have big campfires. During the day, there was more washing. This is several days after that first washing you saw. Of course, the commissary boys who were hired by the club to do this kind of work had to collect the wood and prepare it for our campfires and our cook fires. Well, here's a little interesting sequence showing the fun in a nearby creek and the comparative agility of the big strong man and a clumsy little kid. This little boy, age 14, did it differently. Well, there was plenty of time to relax in camp. We stayed here, I think, 4 days. And some of the boys built this little water wheel using a natural stream that came by. And of course, in the evening, we did have our enormous campfires. As I said before, there's plenty of firewood. It would just rot if we didn't burn it. After dinner, we would gather around the campfire and have entertainment. This is the Benson Lake Camp. Benson Lake was named for Colonel Benson of the U.S. Army, but they were sent in to protect the park from vandals when it was first declared a park. Well, here's Dan Taché, our cook. He was a professional cook. I worried about his fingers. The camp stoves, of course, were carried, these stoves you see were carried from camp to camp on the pack train. These big pots also, as well as all the food and everything else. Then for actually preparing the food, there were a lot of volunteers, like these women were buttering the lunch buns that we would take in our knapsacks the days we hiked. Chocolate pudding in the river to cool off. And this packer, having lots of time while we were enjoying ourselves, carved this little chain out of a single piece of wood. There's Lewis Clark with his morning ablutions. And Francis Tappan, son of Claire Tappan. Francis was later a president of the club, many years later. Ansel Adams on the left is trying to get Francis to pose for a picture. And here is Cedric Wright on the right. He is an author of Sierra Club books. Well, now we'll walk out to the beach. Benson Lake has a beautiful beach at the north end, that's the upstream end. And we spent a whole day on this beach, either doing nothing or talking or playing games. So I just set up the camera and swung it around and you can see how ambitious we were. These are a couple of the commissary boys. They were college boys who were employed by the club to do such things as setting up the stoves, gathering the wood, and so forth. Also, we would frequently have a bandana show like this, where people could put their favorite bandanas on the line. Here's Vera Dawson doing a bunch of front handsprings. Here, some of the bigger boys carried the littler boys, and it was a tug of war to see who could pull the other one over. And here's Ansel Adams making up Nate Clark as a girl for the campfire show. Take a quick look as I walk by. Some famous climbers, Glen Dawson, Jack Rigglehuth, Lewis Clark, Norman Clyde, and I don't remember the last fellow, I'm sorry. Here's Norman Clyde, famous for his heavy packs, his rescue trips, and making difficult ascents. Serious rope climbing was just in its infancy when these pictures were made, and there were many people who didn't know a thing about it. So we set up training here on the cliff right above camp, and we taught people how to climb, how to protect the other climbers, how to belay, that is, how to rope down, and about the signals used in roping. The fellow on the left with the big hat is Ansel Adams. Here Glen Dawson is going to tie a bowline and a bight. That's the kind of a rope that the climbers used, so if they would fall, they wouldn't fall very far. Those who didn't climb, of course, most of them, came out and watched. This husky young fellow, Tony Chalton, came from New Zealand just to join the Sierra Club party. There's Jack Rigglehuth on the left and Lewis Clark on the right belaying the climber. This is probably this fellow's first attempt to rope down, snubbing the rope around his body so that he didn't have to hold his weight with his hand. Here's Vera Dawson, doing his bit and roping down. After spending